Today I'm going to show you some of the possibilities offered by the CO2 laser cutter and engraver sent to me a few days ago for testing. It's called xTOOL P2, and after using it to do a few projects, I believe it's a perfect laser for a studio or workshop owned by creative people who do innovative projects and need versatility and speed. Besides, its compact size, safety, and ease of operation will help you do more creative projects at home. These are the ports to connect it to a PC. It can be through USB, a LAN cable, or Wi-Fi. Since my PC is a little far away, I'm using Wi-Fi. On the other side, there's an emergency switch. When opening the door, you can see the interior and the laser head. I'm going to show you some of the projects I've done, which you'll be able to see in this video. To begin with, this handsaw looking thing, which of course is not for cutting wood. I'll show you what it's for in a few minutes. I've also made several kinds of earrings from my own designs, such as these violin-shaped ones. I've tried doing engravings on anodized aluminum with some success, I believe. I've cut and engraved on acrylic this 3D-looking cat. Finally, I used the laser to cut the letters for this LED light box sign with my logo. This laser only requires a few adjustments before we start using it. The only indispensable step is to fill a tank with distilled water to refrigerate the laser tube. To do this, we have to remove a cover in the back of the machine. Here we can see the laser tube and the water tank. It's important to use distilled water to avoid impurities. If you live in a cold area, you have to mix the water with antifreeze in the amount specified by the manufacturer. This laser has a built-in fan to extract the smoke it generates when in operation. Here we have to attach the standard tube. An optional but worthwhile step is, before using it for the first time, ensure the mirrors that guide the laser to the laser head are properly aligned. The program to operate the laser, called xTOOL Creative Space, has a tool to help us run this check. You only have to click on Settings, then Optical Path Setup. After that, we have to move the laser head to the opposite corner. Now we stick a piece of masking tape on the laser head hole and select Pulse. This is the hole cut by the laser. It must be centered in the laser head hole. It seems to be correct, so in my case I won't have to make any more adjustments. If necessary, we have to adjust the mirror by following the instructions provided by the app. It's time to start playing with my new toy. First of all, I'm going to cut some earrings I designed myself. I'll use one of the soft plywood sheets that came with the laser. The first step is to put the plywood on the laser grid. I open the program and press the camera button to take a picture of the piece. This laser has two cameras. One is long range and the other one is short range, right next to the laser head. Now I import the vectors for the earrings and place them over the picture of the workpiece. I've created two layers. The first one is for the interior cuts, and the second one is for the exterior. I'll use the default cutting settings for different materials that come with the program. Here we can see how easy it is for this laser to cut through 3 mm of plywood at full speed. I was also surprised by how well the smoke extraction system works. The cuts are perfect, and the laser barely burns the wood. We only need to sand down both surfaces a little to remove the marks in the areas that got a little burned. I'm going to color some of the earrings. The lighter wood on the outer surfaces of the plywood is perfect for this. I'll use black, red, blue, and yellow dyes, diluted in a little alcohol. After coloring them, I coated them with a varnish spray. Now all that's left to finish these earrings is to attach the hooks. I'd be interested to see if this laser can cut through hardwood, and I'm going to use this leftover wood from making guitars. First, I'm going to cut some ebony pieces. Ebony is one of the hardest kinds of wood, so I'm going to set the power almost to the maximum and try to make the cut in three passes. I'll also use rosewood. The laser burned some parts of the ebony, but overall I'm very impressed with the results. It cut through the rosewood without any issues. In this case, after sanding it down, I apply some beeswax. Here we can see the end result. I like the look of the plain soft plywood. I also like the red and black earrings, but I'm not so keen on the blue and yellow ones. Now I'd like to show you one of the earrings made with ebony and a black tinted one, to see if you can tell which is which. Which one do you think is the ebony one? Leave a comment. In this case, I don't think the ebony is worth buying. It's very expensive and you can get them to look perfect with a black dye. Rosewood is a different story. It has beautiful grain and more nuanced coloring, almost impossible to achieve with dyes. Another detail I'd like to mention is how easy it is for the laser to cut small pieces and closed angles. I've achieved a lot more definition in the cuts compared to the earrings I made years ago with my homemade CNC. Besides, because I had to use the router bits that were very small in diameter, they broke easily. If you're interested in making these earrings with your laser or CNC, I'll leave a link in the video description so that you can download the files for free on my website. Before moving on, I'd like to show you how to use the link on sharpening that you'll find in the description of this video, which will give you a discount on the purchase of this laser. The link will lead you to xTOOL's site, and there you have to find the laser that interests you most. In this case, I'll show you the one I'm using, the xTOOL P2. As you can see, there are several purchase packs with different accessories. The first one only includes the laser. The second one adds a riser base to work with taller workpieces, and a rotary tool to work with cylinder-shaped workpieces, spheres, or rings. The third one has an automatic conveyor feeder to work with longer workpieces, and the last pack adds a smoke purifier on top of all that. Now I'm going to try to make a new and improved tool to adjust the height of the retractable wheels I use on my workbenches. This is the one I made years ago, but it has two problems. Due to the rack being straight, it's easy to bump against the front and back parts of the wheel that are made of metal. Besides, I made it with HPL, a material that's much harder than the plastic of the cogwheel, and I've noticed it's starting to warp it. This is the new design with a curved rack. This time I'm going to use maple hardwood. I'll try to cut this 10mm thick piece with a laser at full power, and in three passes, as well as engraving some details into the wood. It seems it's cut it without any issues, and now all that's left is to glue the three parts of the adjustment tool together, using some brass rods to reinforce the handle. I think the result is quite decent, even on the edges of the wood. It doesn't cease to amaze me that a laser can cut through maple wood so easily. With this new tool, I managed to almost completely avoid the two issues I mentioned earlier. Here you can see the marks that the old tool left on the cogwheel. If you have this kind of wheel at home and you're interested in making this adjustment tool, I'll also leave a link in the description of this video so that you can download the files for free. I also want to engrave these anodized aluminum hold-down clamps. First, I have to place them on the laser grid, with their upper surface being level. To do this, I have to remove one of the grid slats and use my digital angle finder. Now I'm going to put some vectors on the picture taken by the laser. I'll use the closed view capture camera. I ran some tests with another piece of aluminum to work out the necessary parameters. I'll leave the laser door open this one time only, so that we can better see the engraving process. Don't try this at home, it's dangerous. The result is excellent. I wasn't expecting this definition on anodized aluminum. If you're wondering where this kind of hold-down clamps are useful, let me show you. I normally use them to hold work pieces on the table saw sled, both for cutting horizontally and vertically. The next test will be to score and cut 4mm thick transparent acrylic. To do this, I'm going to make a lamp with this file of a cat I downloaded from the internet. I'm going to score the inner mesh and cut the contour, with the settings provided by the program itself. I've bought a base with LED lights into which I have to insert the acrylic. The result is amazing, it's like you're seeing a cat in 3D. All that's left to do is to make an LED light box sign with my logo so I can put it up in my workshop. First, I'm going to make the box out of black tinted MDF. I'm going to cut all the pieces with the table saw and the router table. I cut the rebates for the acrylic and the back piece. To put the frame together, I'll use packing tape and wood glue. The front frame will be attached with glue and a nail gun. Now I'll cut the acrylic and the back piece to size. I'll use the handheld router to cut some rebates, allowing me to attach some keyhole hanger fasteners that will let me hang the light box on the wall. Lastly, I sand down the box and apply a couple of coats of nitro lacquer spray. Now I'm going to cut the letters from these pieces of MDF. I don't have enough material, so I'm going to join two boards. I place them on the laser and ensure they're square. I open the xTOOL Creative Space program and place the logo in the center of the board. I ran some tests earlier to see what kind of settings I should use with this board. I'm going to use full power and advance about 15mm per second. I managed to make the cut, but some of the areas got a little burned. I don't know if it's because the board is black. I'll have to keep testing in order to cut MDF correctly. I sanded down all the letters and apply a couple of coats of nitro lacquer spray. It's time to glue the letters onto the acrylic. I'll use the original board to position them faster. To glue them on, I'm going to use cyanoacrylate along with its accelerator. I'm also going to put some aluminum adhesive tape on the frame of the sign to reflect the light. Now I'll put the self-adhesive LED strip on the frame. Looks like everything's correct, but I want to install a switch to turn the sign on and off when needed. To fasten the acrylic to the sign, I'm going to use some feed floor protectors, which I've modified a little. All that's left now is to screw on the back piece, where I've also put aluminum tape, and to screw on the keyhole hanger fasteners so that I can hang the sign. That's all for today. In a few days I'll post new videos doing more projects with this laser. Thank you for watching this video until the end.